Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So, our call to worship this morning is from Isaiah. So, no, it's not. It's from Psalm 119, verse 1. Happy are those whose lives are faultless, who live according to the law of the Lord. Our first hymn this morning will be very familiar for most of us, I would think. And it sets up the main theme for our service this morning, which in the lectionary refers to this Sunday as Christ the King Sunday. So that's going to be our theme, or one of our themes this morning. So we're going to start our service by singing, by raising our voices in praise to God. It's hymn 127, "O Worship the King, All Glorious Above." Into this place of worship, as so many have done before us, down through the years. We come together as a community of your people, called from our homes to come into your house so that we may meet you as you welcome each one of us into your house and into your presence. Loving God, we come knowing that we have not always followed the paths that you have laid set down before us, instead going our own way. We have not listened to you, instead allowing your word to be lost in the cacophony of the busyness of our everyday lives. We have not looked after our neighbour as you have commanded us to do. Loving God, forgive our many faults and failings this past week for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who took our sins on himself so that we may appear before you washed clean without blemish. We do not understand why you do this for us, Lord, but we sing our songs of praise in glad thanksgiving that you are a God of love and mercy and not a God of blame and retribution. And so we can sing our praises to you with our hearts restored and a new joy on our lips as we make our way from here to our homes and into the week ahead, whatever that will bring. Father God, in our service today, open our ears to hear what you would say to each one of us. Open our hearts so that we may respond in faith to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. And open our minds to help us understand what you would have us do in your name as we go from this place into our communities. Lord God, hear our prayers. And now, let us pray using the words that Jesus taught the disciples to say when they prayed together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and lead us as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. For my first thought, I thought I would treat you to a wee quiz to get the brain cells working. What do these three people have in common? Robert the Bruce, Richard II, and Charles III. What do they all have in common?
Kings.
They're all kings, exactly. It's not a hard quiz. The next bit is, what are their dates? Ah, no, we won't go that far. Of course they are, they're all kings. Robert, I'll give you the dates. Robert the Bruce ruled Scotland from 1306 to 1329. Richard II ruled England from 1367 to 1400. And Charles III took the throne of the United Kingdom in 222. But there is another king that we're going to be thinking about today, and I wonder if you can work it out who this king is. The only clue I will give you is that he has reigned for a very, very long time, and it's not a trick question. Yes, of course it is, Jesus. He is our king, and he's going to be our focus of our service this morning. Now, we're going to have our next hymn. This is a wonderful hymn with positive words of what it is like to follow Jesus, no matter who we are or where we are or what our situation is. And it's hymn 510. And if you're using the hymn books rather than looking at the screen, we are only singing verses 1-3. So hymn 510. Jesus calls us here to meet him.
Amen. Our first lesson this morning is from Psalm 93, which can be found in the Pew Bible, page 594. Psalm 93. God is King. The Lord is King. He is clothed with majesty and strength. The earth is set firmly in place, that cannot be moved. Your throne, O Lord, has been firm from the beginning, and you existed before time began. The ocean depths raise their voice, O Lord. They raise their voice and roar. The Lord rules supreme in heaven, greater than the roar of the ocean, more powerful than the waves of the sea. Your laws are eternal, Lord, and your temple is holy indeed, forever and ever. Our second lesson is from John chapter 18, reading verses 33 to 37. Find it in the New Testament at page 142, John 18, verses 33 to 37. Pilate went back to the palace and called Jesus. "Are you the King of the Jews?" he asked him. Jesus answered, "Does this question come from you, or have others told you about me?" Pilate replied, "Do you think I am a Jew? It was your own people and the chief priests who handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom belonged to this world, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish authorities. No, my kingdom does not belong here." So Pilate asked him, "Are you a king then?" May God add his blessing to this, the reading of his holy word, and to his name be the praise and glory, now and forevermore. Amen.
Our next hymn, which will take us into the service, into the sermon, we'll highlight one of the key themes in our service this morning and starts with part of a very well-known quotation. And it talks to us today of the turbulent times that face many people in our world today. So hymn 710, "I Have a Dream," a man once said. Hymn 571.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, to whom be all honour and glory. Amen. If we were to carry out a detailed survey of all the monarchs who reigned in the British Isles since, let's say, 1066, just to get a timeline on it, I am fairly sure that we would discover rogues and scoundrels, along with those who at least tried to rule in a just way for the benefit of those they ruled over. Of course, monarchs are just like everyone else. They make mistakes, they get things wrong, sometimes spectacularly so. But being monarchs, when they did get something wrong, it was usually the common people who suffered for it. To see what monarchy should look like, we can turn to our reading from Psalm 93 that Connie so beautifully read for us just a minute ago. This psalm is thought to be part of a larger group of psalms for use in a religious festival, perhaps to celebrate the anniversary of some significant date, which is now lost to us, so we don't really know where this psalm sits, but it's a wonderful psalm nonetheless. And there's no doubt about who the subject of this psalm is. The Lord is King. And because the Lord is King, he is clothed in majesty and strength. In fact, God does not have to put on garments of majesty and strength, because he is majesty and strength. And as we explore this gem of a psalm further, we can see what the psalmist is trying to get across. There are no boundaries to limit what God can do. He existed before time. And even the untamable oceans obey his command, because he is the creator God who first created the oceans and set limits to where they can go and what they can do, all of which we can read in Genesis chapter 1. And God's authority over his creation is boundless. There are no areas where God's rule doesn't apply, because he is the creator. And in Luke chapter 8, we see Jesus the Son exercising the same power over creation when he calmed the storm, as recorded in Luke 8. I quote, "Jesus got up and gave an order to the wind and the stormy water. They died down, and there was a great calm." Jesus has the same authority as the Father, because the three-in-one Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, are united as one. The psalmist also declares that the earth is set firmly in place and cannot be moved. We know there are those who believe science can explain everything, and with no need to recourse to religious mumbo-jumbo. And they might be tempted to gloat knowingly and say, aha, we know the earth revolves around the sun, so it cannot be set firmly in place. But that's not what this psalm is saying. What it means is that the earth has its place in the cosmos. And as the universe revolves around and within the planetary system we see in our night skies, Earth keeps within its allotted orbit. So the Earth is indeed set firmly in place, just that place happens to be orbiting. It is focused in the psalm, with only five verses, one of the shortest psalms, but it is focused entirely on the majesty of our Lord God. From the stars in the sky to the depths of our ocean, our Lord reigns supreme. Consequently, the throne of God is set securely in its place, and its place is with the Lord, where the Creator can be worshipped and glorified by every created being with a voice. And even the ocean depths will praise the Lord with the roar of their waves. And the unknown psalmist declares that his confidence that the Lord's laws are eternal and imbued with the holiness of the temple where God sits in majesty and justice. As I said, a small psalm with a mighty kick. So now we turn to our reading from the Gospel, and there is a bit of a surprise waiting for us here. We are on the cusp of Advent. It starts next week. Sorry to come, please. But our readings from John's Gospel takes us to the interrogation of Jesus by Pontius Pilate. This is not a mistake. There is a good reason for this reading being here. By bringing this reading into such close proximity to the season of Advent like this, we are being told that we need both of these events, Jesus in the manger and Jesus on the cross, if we are to fully understand what is meant when we talk about Christ the King. Earlier on, we spoke about briefly about monarchs in history and how fickle they could be sometimes. The most important part of being a monarch was to rule over the people in the kingdom. And as I mentioned earlier, some were more loved than others. Some took their responsibilities more seriously than others. But the ones who were best loved by the people were the monarchs who reigned with justice for all the people, and not just for the elite or their cronies. This doesn't just apply to monarchs, male or female, but to all who have responsibilities, nationally or locally. Heads of states, presidents, prime ministers, whatever the title is, they have a duty to serve those they rule over. I'm not an expert in these things, and I imagine people in that position in their own lands probably have to make a pledge to do just that. President-elect Donald Trump will be sworn into the presidency of the United States early in the new year, and he will make certain pledges to serve the people of the nation. And we may have watched previous inaugurations of US presidents, and it's quite a moving moment as the oaths are taken. And although he will not be our president, we should or must pray for him and his administration as he guides his nation over the next 4 years, no matter what we might think of his politics. And indeed, we must pray for our administrations in the various parts of the United Kingdom. And that includes our constitutional monarch, Charles III. If you watched the coronation a couple of years ago, then you'd have seen promises and pledges were made. But let's take a closer look at our reading from John's Gospel. We are very familiar with the background to these events, which brings Jesus and Pilate face to face. So in our reading today, Jesus has already had to answer for his actions in the court of the high priest, the religious leader. And now he is brought before the political leader who governs the whole province, Pontius Pilate, who starts the encounter with a direct question. Are you the King of the Jews? The way that the Greek works in this question is to emphasize the word you. It's as if Pilate is thinking, how can you, bloodied, beaten, barely standing, be any kind of a king? And Jesus answers Pilate's question with another question, as he does so often. Is this your own question, or did someone else tell you about me? This challenges Pilate to reveal what he actually knows. And actually, even if Jesus had said yes to that question, it was not actually a crime. The Jewish leaders could have sorted all that out for themselves. There was no need to involve the Roman authorities at all. Now, I am fairly confident that most of us will have seen our fair share of courtroom dramas on the TV or in a film or maybe in a book by an author like John Grisham or something. And even though we are not lawyers, we know the prosecution side should make it clear what the accused is alleged to have done. But there's only halfway through the conversation before Pilate asks that very basic question. What have you done? He might as well have said, what have you done to get yourself standing in front of me? It would seem the Jewish authorities didn't even give Pilate that most basic information. Now, I know this happened 2,000 years ago, but we are not talking about some backward nation with Wild West justice where might is always right. The Romans had a very advanced and sophisticated legal system with many of the checks and balances that we would probably recognise in our own systems today. And neither was Pilate just a simple soldier obeying orders from his superior. As governor of the province, he could rule the province exactly as he saw fit. As long as he raised lots of tax revenues to send back to Caesar, he could do what he liked. He was a diplomat and a political operator, no doubt relying on a network of informants keeping him up to date with where the trouble stops were and where the movers or shakers are doing, who's forming alliances with whom, and should he do anything about it. He would be well versed in how the legal system should work. And in my mind, it is inconceivable that a man of standing and authority should so blatantly disregard due process of law in the way that Pilate did, just because the religious leaders asked them to. The Jews could not kill anyone, as their own laws forbade it. And in Roman law, the state could not kill anyone without going through due process. But the Jewish authorities were fully responsible, in collusion with Pilate, in having Jesus killed. Legally, it was indefensible. Morally, it was reprehensible. But, and it's an important but, the catastrophic failure of the Jewish authorities and Pilate to follow due processes had to happen. You see, Jesus had to die on that cross, on that hill, outside that city, on that day. And Jesus knew it. He referred to it many times with the disciples. He couldn't process that thought and said, "Don't say these things, Jesus. It's too upsetting." But it was ordained by God from the beginning of time that the Son of God would die on Calvary Hill. This does not absolve the Jewish leaders or Pilate in any way in their part in this. And in the second part of this conversation, Jesus tells Pilate that he has a kingdom, but is not of this world. And Jesus points out that his followers are not involved in any wrongdoing, making it quite clear that Jesus and his disciples are no threat to Pilate, or Rome, for that matter. That is why the followers of Jesus are not rebelling against the Roman oppressors or the Jewish authorities. Many of them probably have gone into hiding after the arrest of Jesus. But in hearing the words, "My kingdom," Pilate jumps in, "So you are a king." And once again, Jesus says, "That's your words, not mine." And it's only then that Jesus reveals why he came. "I was born and came into the world for this purpose, to speak about the truth. Whoever belongs to the truth listens to me." Of all the words that Jesus said in this passage, surely this is far and away the most provocative. That truth dwells with Jesus and nowhere else. Truth certainly wasn't present when Jesus was arrested, or when he faced the Sanhedrin, or when Pilate finally decided to execute Jesus. To fully understand the context of this passage, we have to look at it in regard to what was happening beyond the walls of Pilate's inner sanctum. It was Passover, the biggest and most important of the feast days. Jews came from all over the region to be in Jerusalem for the Passover. The city would have been thronged with people and their families. Think of Edinburgh and the festivals, and then add a whole ton of more people. It was a time of high emotion, and not all visitors were there for the Passover feast. Petty thefts, arguments over the cost of sacrificial food, and many other things as well. Odd bit of drunken behaviour meant that the Romans had a high profile to keep the peace as best they could, much like what happens here today. when crowds are large crowds are anticipated at big events. The police will have a high profile to deter any unrest. So feelings were running high because of the importance of the Passover feast. But in addition, two men were to be executed by the Romans, which added to the tension. And we know that there would be a third cross erected for a man who had done nothing wrong, but who had followed his father's wishes without complaint and with no legal charge against his name. So this is why these readings come together, so that we can get just the tiniest glimpse of God's ultimate plan. This is a plan that has been unfolding ever since humanity decided that it didn't want to be in the Garden of Eden, where God and his people lived in harmony, a place where no one went hungry, where mankind and nature worked hand in hand. There was no disease or avarice or discrimination of any kind. But that wasn't enough. We wanted more. And we wanted some elusive idea called freedom. Freedom to do our own thing, to go our own way, to be whatever we wanted to be. And God, in his infinite wisdom and mercy, opened the door to his garden and let humanity work out. We can read this in Genesis 3, verse 22. One final thought, if I may. Before the days of mechanized slaughter, if a battle had to be fought, the king was expected to lead the troops into battle with banners flying high. And as long as the banners flew, the battle was not yet lost. Jesus entered Jerusalem on a donkey, not a war horse. And in the course of events, all his friends had melted away. But Jesus faced the enemy without wavering or flinching until the battle with sin was won. And that is truly the mark of our King and Lord. Amen. You may have picked up that our hymns have been following a theme that is maybe not directly related to the Gospel readings. And our next hymn, 291, continues in this theme, which talks to us about treating people with love, dignity, regardless of colour, gender, race or nationality, wealth or poverty. And it points us to the season of Advent and reminds us of the role of Mary, who also obeyed her God when he called her by name to do something extraordinary. And we remember her love for her Lord God down through the ages. And this song ends with a simple idea: be blessed, prepare the way. So hymn 291, when out of poverty is born a dream that will not die. Thank you. Blessed are you, Lord God, from the first time to the last. Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the splendour and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on the earth is yours. Of your own, we now give you for the Lord, for the good of your church and for the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now with our prayers for our world. God of love and power, we pray for your church in this parish and throughout the world, that through the courage and faith of your people, your word may be preached and lived. We pray for our community, our country, and the nations of the world, that following the ways of truth and justice may be free from bitterness and strife, and by the power of love, of your love, live in peace. We pray for all those who are in trouble, those who are sick, that they may be cared for, those who are lonely, sustained, those who are oppressed, strengthened, those who mourn, comforted. We give you thanks for those who have entered into the joy of peace of your nearer presence. Grant that we may follow their example and come to share with them the glory of everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit is worshipped and glorified forever. Amen. Our final hymn is one of the best loved hymns in the book. And while it focuses on the kingship of God rather than the kingship of Christ, it neatly caps the theme of justice and equality, especially in verse 3. So our last hymn is 132, The Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now go in the sense of God, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always.